Well, one of America's most important allies has officially teamed up with Russia in one of the largest de-dollarization efforts we've seen to date. And if you still aren't taking the BRICS organization and de-dollarization seriously, we're going to be breaking down several trends happening around the world and what this means for the future of the US dollar. Now, this all started a couple of weeks ago when India's Prime Minister Modi flew to Moscow to personally meet with Vladimir Putin. The two leaders sat down and discussed the bilateral trade between both nations, which stood at $65 billion last year, up an incredible 33% from the previous year. India is now the top purchaser of Russian oil, and as this graph illustrates, has increased its purchases of Russian oil by a whopping 1,800% since the 2022 invasion of Ukraine. I can't stress how big a deal this is, because while the US and its allies have imposed over 16,000 sanctions on Russia, over 85% of the world hasn't agreed to them. And Russia is finding many creative loopholes, like this partnership with India, to get around every single one of these sanctions. But the latest deal between India and Russia is next level, and it's going to change everything for the BRICS alliance. Because for the first time ever, Russia and India will integrate a new payment system that will allow for seamless cross-border transactions without the need for US dollars. This is important because it's the tip of an iceberg in a massive international effort of countries around the world ditching the US dollar and setting up cross-border transactions in local currencies. At the end of their meeting, Putin and Modi set a goal to achieve $100 billion in trade revenue between Russia and India by 2030, locking in this partnership for the rest of the decade and also giving us a sign of what's next to come for the BRICS organization. In fact, the real winner of de-dollarization has been gold, as all members of BRICS have increased their gold holdings at a faster rate than the rest of the world since 2018. And now one-third of all central banks across the globe are planning on increasing their gold reserves in 2024. Once again, the 16,000 US sanctions against Russia has not done much in terms of stopping Russia's war in Ukraine. And in fact, it's only accelerated more countries around the world to de-risk themselves away from the US dollar and purchase gold instead. Russia will now host the BRICS President Summit this October and will continue to build this new BRICS payment system and also discuss which new countries will be added to the alliance in 2025. Andrei Kostin, the CEO of Russia's VTB Bank, was quoted, "We, BRICS, must develop our own settlement system that includes the Global South, enabling us to conduct transactions in our own national currencies and not the US dollar. India has a positive attitude towards working with Russia." For many months, there has been a lot of speculation that BRICS would be launching an entirely new currency. But the BRICS alliance have now turned their attention away from a shared currency and are now moving towards this new cross-border payment system. To be honest, it's a smart move, as using homegrown payment systems and local currencies will save BRICS millions in exchange rates while also strengthening their local currencies and economies. But it's not just Russia and India making deals. China also wants to use more of its local currency and launch the cross-border interbank payment system, also known as KIPS, which settles international transactions directly in renminbi. In the past 12 months, KIPS added 62 direct participants and now counts over 1,500 participants around the world with access to China's new payment system. This is just adding to the growing trend of countries around the world shifting away from the harsh restrictions of using US dollars and being forced to send those dollars through the US-controlled SWIFT banking system. But a few days ago, major news broke out in Guangdong as China has taken it one step further and officially launched the first real trade service of its central bank digital currency. And this is potentially a major deal for the future of BRICS. China is by far the most advanced nation in the world in digital currency development, with estimations that China has a 10-year lead on the United States in digital currency development. Now, to be fair, with the US dollar status as the world's reserve currency, there hasn't been a lot of motivation by the US government to develop its own digital currency. But on the flip side, China's government is hoping their investments into digital currencies will pay off much like their early investments into the EV industry some 25 years ago. China went from zero to hero in the EV industry the past two decades and is now the most dominant EV power in the world. China's digital currency will not only reduce transaction costs and improve the efficiency of cross-border transactions, but it also has the chance to serve as the key technology for the future trade between BRICS members. But here is where things get interesting. Because last week, the International Monetary Fund just revised its world economic outlook, and you might be surprised by the latest predictions for BRICS member countries against their Western counterparts. The IMF revised higher its outlooks for China and India to 5 and 7% respectively, while the United States is the only nation in the G7 forecasted to grow above 1%. The entire euro area is only 0.9%, with Europe's economic powerhouse, Germany, forecasted to produce the lowest growth rate of any developed nation with only 0.2% growth. Once again, this is quite the contrast with the bottom half of this graph, which shows six BRICS members, China, India, Russia, Brazil, South Africa, and Saudi Arabia, experiencing some of the best growth predictions for the remainder of 2024. This was further broken down in this article from the New York Times, which predicts the cooling of the US economy in the future. It's nice to finally see some truth being reported on this matter, because for most of the year, the dominant headline has been China's economy being on the verge of a collapse because of weak consumer spending and a softening job market. But that's exactly how the IMF described the US economy. Just take a look at this graph, which forecasts economic growth, and you'll see why the IMF describes Asia's emerging markets as the main engine for the global economy, with growth in China and India accounting for nearly half of all global growth. The simple reality here is that inflation still remains a major issue in the US economy. The national debt is increasing at a historic rate of nearly $1 trillion every 100 days, and finally, the US faces an incredible amount of political uncertainty. As such, more and more nations across the globe are losing faith in the entire US political system. If you need proof, just look at this chart, which shows the US is no longer seen as a shining example of democracy. Even some of America's strongest allies, like Germany, Great Britain, and Canada, all agree the United States used to be a good example, but hasn't been in recent years, with nearly a quarter of Brits and Germans feeling the US has never been a good example. But the race of the US presidency goes well beyond the US border, and the outcome will have global ramifications. This new IMF report said, the potential for significant swings in economic policy as a result of elections this year with negative spillovers to the rest of the world has increased the uncertainty. And let me give you a firm example of what I mean. Trump first introduced tariffs on Chinese goods back in 2016. Biden doubled down and expanded those tariffs in 2020. And just last week, Bloomberg reported a new 60% tariff could be imposed on Chinese goods if Trump wins back the White House again. But analysts have missed the mark on this analysis, because US tariffs have done very little to affect China exports, as China has simply started producing more for countries throughout the global south, and as a result, has seen their share of exports increase exponentially the past few years. US tariffs on Chinese goods would only hurt the American consumers, and I think Trump is bluffing, because just a few days ago, he floated out the idea of welcoming China inside the US to build their dominant EV cars for the American consumer. Who knows who will win the presidency this November? But now, it's time to shift to the sponsor of today's video, Alaska Energy Metals, which trades under the symbol AKEMF because it plays right into this US-China economic rivalry we are witnessing. Now, I first profiled this company a few months ago, and the stock has been down a bit in recent months. But the company has some pretty outstanding news to share, and we're going to break it all down for you to understand. Now, many of you know that I've been on the ground in China for the past month, and one of the biggest observations I've seen here is the substantial amount of EVs. China is absolutely dominating the EV industry, and it's not even close. Because China controls everything from the supply chains to the battery technology to the minerals. And here is a crazy fact. Nickel is one of the most important metals needed to produce an EV battery. In fact, 64 pounds of nickel go into each EV battery. And the United States, who desperately wants to catch up with China and their EV industry, imports 100% of the nickel that the country uses. This is why last year, the Department of Energy listed nickel as a critical resource in the US. both important to the future of energy and very high on supply risk. Now, Alaska Energy Metals has a chance to be that top nickel supplier for the United States and the EV industry moving forward, and here are five compelling reasons that this company has a chance for breakout success. Number one, financing. The company has raised capital to fund its drilling programs and additional capital expenditures, first at Canadian 50 cents, then 40 cents, then 28 cents, and most recently at 15 cents. The stock is now trading around the 15 to 16 Canadian cent level, which means that you'll be buying shares at a cheaper price than many institutional investors. Number two, management upgrades. Now, in order to capitalize on this opportunity, Alaska Energy Metals needed to upgrade their management. Now, they brought in three real legends in the mining industry to serve on their board of directors and advisory board. The first is Mario Vetro, who has joined the board of directors and will be instrumental going forward. Mario co-founded K92 Mining, which employs 1,600 people in Papua New Guinea and produces high-grade, low-cost gold and trades for a nearly $2 billion market cap. He brought with him Ian Stalker, who previously served as the CEO of K92 Mining, and both of these guys add excellent depth to the board of directors. They are, of course, incentivized mostly by share compensation, so they want to drive value immediately. Finally, Paul Matzek joined the advisory board. Now, Paul is a legend in the mining and gold industry and saw an opportunity here with Alaska Energy Metals. His specialty is joining projects early and helping them get acquired later on. And make no mistake, that most definitely is one of the longer term goals for this company. Number three, peer comparison.
Now let's go to the stock market and do a live comparison at the time of this recording. Alaska Energy Metals owns a nickel resource containing 8 billion pounds of nickel, and its market cap is 13.4 million Canadian dollars, which is undervalued when we compare it to Canada Nickel, who owns a resource of 13 billion pounds of nickel and has a market cap of 197.5 million Canadian.
If the management and board of directors can execute their game plan correctly, there is a great potential for a price increase that puts this company closer to their peers in terms of valuation. Number four, valuation. The previous two owners of the Alaska Energy Metals Nikolai Nickel Project spent a collective $36 million since the 1990s, before Greg Beischer, the CEO of Alaska Energy, took control of it. In other words, the company's market cap today is 66% below what previous owners had already spent on it. So once again, we are looking at an undervalued asset that has serious potential for appreciation. And number five is Cobalt Metals. This is actually one of the most interesting points about this project. Right next to Alaska Energy Metals is another mining company, Cobalt Metals, a privately held AI-driven mineral exploration company whose shareholders include Michael Bloomberg, Jeff Bezos, Bill Gates, Jack Ma, Ray Dalio, and Richard Branson. There is a lot of smart money in the area, and interesting enough, Cobalt Metals actually acquired mineral rights right next to Alaska Energy Metals Nikolai Project, and then purchased mining data from Alaska Energy Metals last year. Now everyone, as we conclude today's video, I want to share a couple more interesting market trends. Gold, which many of you know I am very bullish on, also just hit an all-time high. And I honestly feel that we are going to see a lot more demand for these precious metals and mining stocks in the future. Why? Because like I mentioned earlier in the video, the EV industry continues to improve, expand, and get better. Tesla, which full disclosure I own a position in, has rallied by 35% in the past month alone. China and the US are going to compete in many areas moving forward, but the US has a long way to go. Hence, why Joe Biden imposes 100% tariffs on Chinese EVs to help American companies catch up. Nickel is going to be a valuable resource for the future of America, and once again, Alaska Energy Metals has the potential to fill that need. Now, as always, I want to remind you to do your own research and make your own decisions before making any investments. And to help you with that, I'm going to be putting the Alaska Energy Metals stock ticker, the website, and investor presentation down in the description below. Once again, thank you all for your incredible support, and I look forward to seeing you all in our next video soon.